Good morning then, and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. We have to consider whether to take items four and five in private. Item four is a consideration of evidence we will hear today under agenda item two. And item five is a consideration of our approach to the committee report on our inquiry into the role of local government in delivering net zero targets. Are we all happy to take those items in private? We are. So they will be taken in private, and we'll move now on to agenda item two, which is an evidence session on Scottish Water's annual report and accounts for 2021-22. I refer members to the clerks and Spice papers on this item. On the 31st of May 2022, Scottish Water published its annual report and accounts for the previous year 21-22, setting out its financial and operational performance for the previous years. Earlier this year, the committee agreed to hold a one-off evidence session with Scottish Water to consider its report. It was also agreed for this session to include representatives of Business Stream and the Water Industry Commission for Scotland to explore broader questions around water and sewerage in Scotland. And I'd like to welcome the panellists who will join us today. First of all, Dame Susan Rice, the Chair of Scottish Water, Douglas Milliken, the Chief Executive of Scottish Water, Peter Farrer, Chief Operating Officer of Scottish Water, Alan Sutherland, the Chief Executive, Water Industry Commission for Scotland, and Joanna Dow, the Chief Executive of Business Stream. Thank you all for accepting our invitation. And we'll move straight into questions, which are going to start today to come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us this morning. I want to focus on net zero initially, and I'll direct my questions to Douglas Milliken first, and then probably Joanna Dow, if you think you can come in on this as well. So the fairly open question is, what progress has been made on Scottish Water's roadmap to net zero, and what do you see as the key challenges ahead? And you might want to break that down to short-term, medium-term and long-term. Douglas, are you happy to answer that one?
Very much so. So thank you for that. We've had a long-term commitment to decarbonising our activities. And if we look at our operational emissions, our operational carbon footprint is now about half...
I always like to admit when I'm wrong, which doesn't happen very often, I'm glad to say, but I am wrong in this case because I did promise some opening statements, which is why Susan looked at me as if I was on a different planet. And indeed, Susan, I would say that I was on a different planet this morning, and I apologise profusely. And I'm going to come back to your question, if I may.
Are you apologising to me or to the panel?
Only this morning. Susan, would you like to give an opening statement? Sorry.
Convener, I thought I never gave anything away with my expressions. But let me just say thank you to you and to the committee for having us. And looking back and the key highlights from that latest annual report, 21 to March 2022, which you mentioned, we can all see that the last year really was quite extraordinary. We faced, as you all know, we all know, extreme weather, intensifying climate change, challenging economy with steep and quick cost rises. Like most organizations, Scottish Water had to respond and adapt with speed and agility. Despite these challenges, Scottish Water and Business Stream had a successful year each while keeping focused on delivering for our customers. That's always at the center. Our dedicated teams had to work hard to keep customers in water as some of our reservoirs fell to previously unknown levels in 2021, whilst at the other extreme also managing the effects of storms Arwen, Corrie and Malik, which caused significant disruption to power supplies, especially in the northeast of Scotland and for a prolonged period of time. With inflation and the cost crisis continuing to show little sign of calming down, and a growing need to manage these significant climate challenges, as well as the challenge of aging assets, we will need to continue to be innovative and resilient moving forward. Above all, we have to keep moving forward. We are under no illusion of how difficult this will be if income and future charge increases are not fully achievable due to wider considerations. Moving forward, we'll need to continue to work with all industry stakeholders to make sure we continue to focus investment on key priorities and meet our net zero emissions ambition. So I think that leads right back to the deputy convener's question.
Well, not quite, because the one person, there was another person who was offered an opening statement, Alan Sullivan. Did you want to make an opening statement?
I think it's probably best, convener, just let the questions.
Okay. Well, all I can say is I'm not going to play cards with you because you kept a very straight face when I obviously made an error. So I will go back to the deputy convener. And do you want to ask your question again?
Clearly net zero is the most important ambition for all of us if we're going to make a difference to our planet. We've just come through COP27. Scottish Water has key responsibilities in this area. So my question is about your route map to net zero and what progress has been made. What do you see as the key challenges in the short, medium and long term? To Douglas Milliken first, please.
Okay. Thank you for that question. So decarbonising our activities has been a really long-term commitment and priority of Scottish Water. And we're now in a position where, in terms of our operational emissions footprint, we've halved the level of carbon that's consumed in our operations. But given the significance of the issue, when we were setting our strategic plan, looking out really towards the middle of the century, we settled on three core ambitions that Scottish Water should be focusing on. And one of those three core ambitions is about getting to net zero emissions and then beyond that. And there are a number of different dimensions to it. So let me start with the operational side, where we've got a really good story so far about halving the operational emissions footprint. Clearly, we want to get that down towards zero. So there's a lot of further progress we can make in terms of driving energy efficiency into operations, further increasing the extent of renewable energy generation that we either generate within our own assets or that is hosted within our land. But one of the trickiest issues in trying to decarbonise our operational emissions are the emissions that effectively are a byproduct of the wastewater treatment process. Things like methane, for example, and about a quarter of our operational emissions relate to those areas. Sitting today, there is not existing technology to decarbonise these fugitive emissions. But that is something that we and the wider water industry around the globe are engaged on and trying to see what could the art of the possible be in terms of decarbonising those. And we're trialling different things out. Part of it is actually just trying to measure where do these emissions actually occur across our wastewater treatment plants. The next big area of our emissions is actually to do with our capital investment programme. We are a major investor, investing about £3 million every day in replacement and upgrade to infrastructure. And that investment consumes significant elements of carbon in terms of abstracting raw materials from the ground, transporting them, processing them, and assembling them. So probably for about 3 or 4 years now, we've been doing a lot of work upstream with our supply chain partners, looking at what can be done in that space. And first of all, it's a hearts and minds challenge. It's actually ensuring that everybody shares the imperative that we all do about decarbonising. But actually, the human side is a really big part here, because if you've got engineers who for 20, 30 years in their careers have got a tried and tested way of building new assets, and they know what works, actually unlearning what works and learning new ways of doing things is a massive challenge in terms of for people professionally. It then plays into the commercial side because it has impacts on risk models. But extensive work that we're doing, and I can simplify it into three key priorities at the moment. Firstly, how can we have lower carbon designs that avoid pumping, use gravity, build above ground and minimise digging? Secondly, what could low carbon materials look like? For example, we're now using low carbon concrete in certain situations. And thirdly, how do we develop more low carbon approaches to construction, such as reusing existing materials and using lower emission plant and equipment? So maybe I'll just pause there. Yeah. But there's a huge amount that we're engaged in, kind of year on year, trying to get towards that goal.
Thank you very much for that. That was very informative. Joanna, have you got any aspects, particularly in terms of your relationships as well? Because it's not just what you do, it's what your customers do as well, isn't it?
Very much so, yes. I think unlike Scottish Water, we're not a huge consumer of electricity. So we're an office-based organisation. We have about 350 people. But nonetheless, we're very focused on how we can reduce our carbon emissions as well. So we set ourselves a target for the year past April to reduce our carbon emissions by 20%, and we achieved a figure of 25.3%. So we've had great support actually from the Scottish Water Group around this, so how to determine what our starting position was, what our carbon footprint was, and then identifying what are the kind of key consumers of carbon within our business. And I would say, similar to most small organisations, it's about travel costs and it's about use of electricity, so we focus specifically on those. And as Douglas said, I think that is a hearts and minds, it's a behavioural change. So trying to actually help encourage members of staff to use energy wisely at work, but at home as well. So it's a constant kind of process, I think, of reminding people of that. I think the other role that we have is, as a supplier to over 300,000 businesses across the UK, we are actively trying to encourage those customers to use less water on the basis that if you use less water, there's less energy consumption as well, and it drives down carbon usage. So big focus on working with customers of all sizes, from corner shops, very small consumers of water, right the way through to huge industrial plants, and really helping to support them with water efficiency, which, as I say, in turn drives down their consumption of electricity.
Thank you. And if I can now move to Peter Farrer, I wonder if you could help with explaining how integrated Scottish Water is in the wider public sector. Operational decisions, for example, around planning, obviously major housing developments, not least in my constituency, overwhelming draining capacity, you know, drainage capacity, that kind of area. And can also ask, following up from what Douglas has said, if methane emissions or other emissions are an issue, we're moving to a circular economy, what connections have you got with the Scottish Funding Council to try and ensure that the research that's been developed in our universities meets the practical and operational needs of by-product emissions? Because that would obviously be key. So how central do you think Scottish Water is within the wider firmament, in the wider kind of public sector?
Yeah, well, we do a lot to make sure that we are completely integrated with the councils, particularly, as you mentioned, in housing developments. We have close connections with all the councils, right from early planning and the strategic plans, right through to more specific working with the councils when we're actually making individual connections. Some of the things that we're working on in particular, one of our biggest issues is surface water in our sewers, causing flooding and pollution. So we're working with a number of councils on specific schemes to try and take surface water out of our sewers. So there's one not far from here, actually, at Craigleith, where we're working with council and developers to identify areas where we can remove surface water at source rather than trying to deal with it when it's actually in the sewers. So we do have lots of integration with the councils all through the development planning process. I think the second thing you asked was about the Scottish Funding Council. I'm actually on the chair of the Scottish Apprentice Advisory Board, and through that we work with the Skills Development Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council to look at the funding for apprenticeships all across different categories, and there's definitely a big move towards more environmental topics, carbon net zero, and trying to make sure that the policies up front are actually meeting the demand that's required from the businesses and the business leaders that are part of the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board.
So that was helpful. I was more interested in R&D, but I'm happy for you to come back on that.
You're happy for me to come in on that. So we've got a lot of different interactions with different universities, but probably the most significant is that we are the sponsors of the Hydronation Chair. which is based at Stirling University, but involving academics at a number of different universities. And they're currently working on about half a dozen different challenges, but many of those have got a climate change-related theme, either from a decarbonisation or in terms of issues to do with how we adapt to climate change.
Okay, thank you. And I just finally, and again, it might be Peter who's best placed to answer this. What changes have you noticed in demand during the COVID-19 pandemic following increases in energy crisis? I mean, they're two separate issues, but in a kind of same time frame. What influences have they had on demand for Scottish Water?
And with demand, you're talking about demand...
Customers. Like
water demand? Or
yeah.
Yep. Well, it's interesting because as soon as COVID started, we saw a fairly immediate change in demand patterns from... and Joe will have some other evidence on this, from businesses that had emptied out and people working from home. So there was a big shift for us in seeing demand for water and for wastewater services switching over from business to household use. That caused us a number of issues, particularly in some of the smaller rural areas, particularly in wastewater, where a small wastewater treatment works in a small rural area has got a certain capacity to deal with the number of people. And that was significantly increased, so we started to see some overload issues coming into wastewater treatment works, which we had to work on and make sure that we had additional plant and equipment available to see us through that period. But I'm pleased to say that we got through the COVID, 2 years of COVID, delivering and continuing to deliver the high levels of service that we delivered to customers before COVID. And I'm particularly proud of that because of, and a shout out to our operational people in particular who kept going all the way through that, delivering the service to customers and maintaining the high level that you see in the report.
And I think we all want to thank those Scottish Water workers for what they did during that period in particular. Has there been anything particularly around energy, the energy price increase, has that caused any difference to you?
Yep. Our energy, we've been in a fortunate position in that we hedge our energy in advance of using it. So this year, our energy was 100% hedged. So we are still utilising energy this year at a weighted average price of about £55 per megawatt hour when the market price is currently up near £300. So we have hedged that this year. We have 47% of our energy use. That's the total energy use, 447 megawatt hours per year. 47% of that is what we call tied up with private purchase arrangements that we've put in place to do with our large renewable schemes that we've hosted on our land. And these run out for a number of years yet. So we're hedged for 47% for a number of years yet. The big issue is the 53% that's remaining we have to buy on the wholesale market. As I said, we're completely hedged for this year up until March, but that 53% we have to start purchasing for next year. And the estimate that we see for that is that it will probably be somewhere between £40 and £70 million extra for the energy based on the current prices.
Thank you, Ms. Convener. Maybe just let Joanna ask about demand for it's more as a customer demand, if you can maybe give a perspective of that, and then I'll hand back to the convener.
Yeah, happily do so. We saw a fairly immediate reduction in consumption from our business customers of 20% following the first lockdown restrictions being introduced in March 2020. So vast majority of businesses across the UK had to close their doors overnight. And what we've really seen since that is a steady recovery. So it started to recover. We went into lockdown again and it dipped off. So where we're at today, though, I would say that we're almost back to pre-COVID levels of consumption. The slowest sector to recover was public sector, and I think we probably all understand that's because there were a number of kind of large offices, etc., that remained closed and are now at partial occupancy. So, yeah, fairly immediate impact from that. And I guess what we're seeing now is, having come through the worst of COVID and through the recovery from that, we're now facing into the worst economic crisis that the UK has seen in a number of years. So from my perspective, dealing with business customers, we are anticipating quite challenging times for many, particularly small businesses, over the course of the next 6 months.
Thank you.
Sorry, Joanna, could I just ask you, I mean, just looking at the accounts that the period in question, the revenue during the first COVID thing appears to be about 54 million down on what it is currently. So that's a sort of 10% drop. Was that all down to COVID, or was that down?
It was. And the thing is, there's kind of consumption-related charges that drive revenue, but there's also fixed charges as well. So what you don't see is that 20% reduction in consumption having a direct correlation on the reduction in revenue, but it was significant.
Yeah, I mean, that was your revenue period, was 54 million down. Yeah. That seems, a 10% drop seems quite large.
Significant, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you. I think the next questions are from Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Moving from demand to the supply, Peter Farrer, climate change appears to be having an increasing impact on the provision of presumably all utilities, and indeed the cost of utilities. This summer, I think we saw record temperatures. Can you tell the committee what impact has that had on your reservoirs? And given, I think Dame Susan earlier said that some had fallen to record levels, have they recovered? And what can you proactively do to manage and mitigate and help to recover in those circumstances?
Okay, so we've seen some fairly significant impacts from weather over particularly this period of the report. In fact, I've been in the water industry for 38 years, and last year was the worst weather impact that we've had, because we were hit by cold weather at the start of the year, really hot weather in early summer, rainstorms in the summer, going into a drought period at the tail end of the year, and then Storm Arwen and Friends came at the end of the year. So it was a fairly significant year of impact for us. But specifically on the hot weather, we started to go into drought in the latter part of the summer, and we saw reservoir levels dropping to levels that we'd never seen before. Particularly South Lanarkshire, there was a couple of reservoirs there that had dropped down, as I said, to levels we hadn't seen. The impact of that was that there were manganese issues. So manganese is a naturally occurring element which is tied up in the silts in the reservoirs. And when we got down to such low levels, and it was the driest period we'd had in that area for 160 years, that when we got down to those levels, manganese was released, went to the treatment works, and because we'd never had manganese issues at those treatment works before, Darren Camp's treatment works, they didn't have the treatment to take the manganese out of the system. What we did do is we had a fairly major incident running with hundreds of Scottish Water people involved in that, delivering bottled water out to customers who were experiencing dirty water. But we also had some really smart process scientists that came up with a temporary treatment solution, which was to inject chlorine into the water between two stages of the existing treatment processes, which precipitated out the manganese and allowed us to take a lot of it out, not all of it, but a lot of it out in the treatment process, and we were able to return our service to near normal. But it didn't completely recover until the reservoir levels started to rise. Picking up on the point, where are we just now? We're currently sitting at 94% full of our reservoirs, and we've got 300 reservoirs, and we monitor these on a weekly basis. and through drought conditions we implement lots of actions which can include tankering water, moving water around about different distribution from different areas and different treatment works. We can find additional raw water supplies. And so we do all things like that to try and make sure that we don't have specific drought impacting our customers. And the final thing that we do when we're concerned is we put communications out to customers to ask customers to use water wisely.
Very grateful. I'll stay with you if you don't mind, Peter. One of the challenges, presumably, that arises from climate change and these mitigations that you're having to put in place will be when you come to replace some of your ageing infrastructure. When you do that replacement, and I'll ask about the capital expenditure in my next question, but when you do the actual replacement, what you are replacing it with, how do you ensure that what you're putting in is future-proofed against what appear to be increasing impacts from climate change?
Okay, so there's a couple of things there. So in terms of the materials that we use, these are all governed under strict regulations with the Drinking Water Quality Regulator. So you can't use anything in our infrastructure unless it's been approved by the Drinking Water Quality Regulator through regulations. The second part, Douglas, do you want to...
Take this. So, I mean, I think this is a really big question for us right across all our infrastructure, because we're no longer dealing with a stable environment of a stable climate. And I think the challenge is to understand what could be the myriad of different impacts over the lifetime of our assets. So when we build new infrastructure, it lasts for 50, 80 years or longer. And it's very difficult to know precisely what the future path is for the climate. We don't yet have an agreed path to climate stability. So the question for us is, what are the plausible impacts that we could have to deal with? And try and ensure that we make choices about investment that are wise and that will be, represent good value for money, while giving us reasonable confidence that they should enable us to deal with whatever future impacts come along. So if I just pull the particular example that Peter was mentioning about Lanarkshire. Having discovered the presence of manganese in a supply system that we'd never previously experienced before, what we are now doing on the back of that, in conjunction with the Drinking Water Quality Regulator, is we're looking at what is our risk position right across Scotland in relation to manganese, to make sure that in the way that we plan our assets and our infrastructure, it takes account of that particular risk. And that's just a subset of a broader thing that we're doing, which is looking at all the different risks to our water supply systems. That could be about availability of water, it could be to do with the quality of water, and ensuring that when we plan interventions, they're designed in the way that hopefully is most effective and cost-effective to dealing with whatever the myriad of challenges or hazards might be in that particular area. So it's very hard to give a single answer to your question, other than to say it's an integral part of our planning.
Peter, did you want to come back in?
Yeah, there's another part there. So as part of our SR15 regulatory contract, we did quite a number of studies for climate change to feed into our 25-year supply-demand balance. So we carried out 54 water supply zone climate change modelling exercises to identify what the future impact of climate change would be on water supply zones. And out of the 54 that we did, 5 showed an increase in water availability and 49 showed a decrease in water availability. So on the back of that, we make sure that our investment is targeted to the areas that will make sure that customer services today and in the future are protected. So that's led to a number of resilience schemes that we've carried out. We've got a big resilience scheme that's linking Glasgow and Ayrshire at the moment. We've had a South Edinburgh resilience scheme and Blair Linnes to Milngavie, which protected the supplies to 40,000 customers. These are on the back of the studies that we carried out, and there's a lot more investment planned.
Very grateful. Final question from me. I'll put to Douglas Milliken and ask the same question to Joanna Dow in a second. Douglas, you talked about capital investment earlier on. As I understand it, your income is basically government loans and the bills that you put out. Your costs for things like electricity will be going up significantly. We heard, notwithstanding that it's hedged, I think you said £70 million extra. We've also heard about the cost of new treatments for manganese. We've heard about drought supply vehicles and things. So these are all putting extra costs on you. What are the implications of those extra operating costs for the capital expenditure that you've presumably planned in for upgrades and for moving to net zero that we heard about earlier?
So probably a number of different elements I'll try and deal with there. In a very broad sense, the costs that we incur generally move broadly in line with inflation in the economy as a whole. And that's why regulated industries like water tend to have long-term regulatory settlements where the price limits that are set are related to a general pricing index. Historically, the prices we could set for regulatory people used to be set by reference to RPI, they're now set by reference to CPI. And that is it's a broad proxy, but it's a pretty good hedge for the sort of costs that we will increases that we'll experience. So in the same way that we might, yes, get a big increase in the costs we incur through energy, we have an eligibility to then reflect that in prices to customers. Different question as to the extent to which we do, but we have that eligibility. So I think that broad regulatory setup serves the sector well and has done over a long time. One element of that whole regulatory arrangement is how capital investment is defined. And historically, if I go to previous regulatory periods, there were basically two different categories of investment. There was what was known as capital maintenance, where we effectively got an allowance to invest in replacing and maintaining our assets. And then on the enhancement side, there was a very detailed list of all the projects that we would deliver in the next 5-6 years by way of upgrades. In this regulatory period, in agreement with our economic regulator and with government, we've now moved into a more flexible approach towards investment planning and delivery, where effectively at the start of the process, we identify often with our quality regulator, SEEP and the drinking water regulator, what improvements might be needed. We then agree with Scottish ministers the needs that will be get investigated and then ultimately probably invest. And then we go away and appraise the different options of meeting those needs and come up with the most cost-effective solutions for delivering those objectives. And our challenge is to make sure we can meet all the needs in front of us, deliver ministers' objectives for this period, inside the financial allowance has been set for the period.
I understand. Joanna Dow, do you have anything to add?
I guess a slightly different context probably for my business because we don't invest in infrastructure. So I think the challenge for us is how do we, with that upward pressure on costs and knowing that doesn't just impact us, it impacts our customers as well. How do we keep our prices for end users sufficiently low, recognising the challenges that they face? So in Scotland, about 80 to 90% of the amount of charge that we pass on to customers is as a result of treating the water, taking away the kind of sewage for treatment as well. So, and I guess the other difference for us is we operate in a competitive market. So we've got about 16, 17 active competitors here in Scotland. So that's a further challenge for us as well. So we know that we have to keep prices low for customers anyway. But if a customer's not happy with the price that we offer or the quality of service that we offer, they'll go somewhere else.
Thank you. PT, have something
to add? If I could just talk about costs and efficiencies. Since Scottish Water was formed in 2002, we've completely transformed the service that we provide to customers, both in terms of customer service and cost. So back at the start in 2002, we were benchmarked to be delivering one of the worst services to customers at the highest cost. And we've completely transformed that over the 20 years to be delivering a leading service at one of the lowest costs. And through that period, we have focused significantly on efficiencies. So yes, there are cost increases that we get every year, but we have a culture of driving efficiencies in our business and always looking for better ways to do it. And even now, we have a transformation plan that we are in the second year of, which is going to deliver significant efficiencies for us going forward.
Very grateful. Camilla.
Just before we move on, Joanna, could I just ask, and I ought to declare that I am a customer of Business Stream, so there we go. Just how do you do all your meter readings? Are they all manually done? Does that require people to go out?
It does.
And is there any plans in the future to try and streamline that?
Yeah. So we supply customers the length and breadth of the UK, and the metering technology that's deployed in different regions is different. So for some of the meters that we read in the south of England, for example, they're all done by drive-by meter reads, so they don't require a physical visit. That's not the case in Scotland. So yes, we have to go out. We use a third-party service provider to go out and read meters on behalf of our customers.
Plan to change?
Again, we don't own the metering assets, they're owned by Scottish Water, but there is investment underway within Scottish Water at the moment looking at what we call smart meter technology, which would allow for more automated provision of meter reads.
Yeah, so if I could maybe just come in on that. So we're looking at putting far more instrumentation and monitors on our networks, and we're running a pilot at the moment up in Inverness, we're calling it Smart City, where we're putting loads of monitors out in the network, including smart meters for businesses, so that we can identify where the demand is, where the water is going, but also it will help us operationally to predict when we're going to have failures of the network so that we can go and fix these before they have any impact on customers.
Perfect. I might see one in my constituency office then. Jackie, yours is the next question.
Good morning and thank you for coming along. In your the Scottish Water's strategic plan, it says that you're going to promote blue-green approaches and drive innovative solutions to reduce flooding. So with that in mind, can I ask what progress has been made in adoption of the blue-green infrastructure to manage surface water, and do you have any examples of the projects? Douglas, I'm going to look at you since you're looking at me.
Okay, well, that's fine. I mean, I think either Peter or I could have taken this. Peter actually cited one of the examples earlier, which is Craigleith in Edinburgh. I think this is one of these concepts that is, when people hear about it, people get really excited about it, which is all about how can we hold more surface rainwater that falls on the surface and slow down the rate at which it comes into sewers, so reducing issues around, for example, flooding. Mm-hmm. And potentially use it as a source of placemaking on the surface. So it sounds really exciting, and it is really exciting. The challenge is, in doing it in practice, is that many, many parties need to be involved. And they need to agree that actually using land for storing rainwater in, let's say, a relatively congested urban area like Edinburgh, it's a better use of that land than developing it for industrial or for housing purposes. So the first challenge actually is getting all the different interested parties on board and them all agreeing that, yes, actually that makes the best sense in the interests of society as well as their particular organisations or businesses. So I think it's one of these where the concept is really easy for people to grasp. And I was, for example, I was at a meeting a couple of months ago here in Edinburgh with a number of the chief executives of local authorities across Scotland, absolutely looking at how do we create water-resilient places in the country. I could point to Craigleith in Edinburgh where we're working, I could point to St Mary's in Dundee, I could point to parts of Glasgow where we're making progress, and there are really encouraging green shoots. But they are green shoots. We've got a long way to go before we really have collectively transformed the urban environment to store surface water on the surface. But we are absolutely committed to doing that, and that's why we're engaging with so many other different parties in it, and often in partnerships. So we've had a long-standing partnership in Glasgow for nearly 20 years called the Metropolitan Glasgow Strategic Drainage Partnership. We've got one here in Edinburgh and Lothians with Edinburgh Council, East and Midlothian Councils. I've got partnership working in Dundee and Aberdeen in particular as well. So lots of encouraging signs, but I think it will be some years before we really see a transformed urban landscape, but no shortage of effort from our side towards it.
Okay. Peter, have you got anything to add?
No,
Okay. And you were speaking about joined up working with other partners. Can you maybe, you spoke about local authorities, can you maybe go into more detail about other public authorities like SEPA, for example, you know, what kind of work, joined up work have you done with them and maybe others?
So SEPA are one of our sectoral regulators. We have very significant interactions with SEPA from the most senior level to the most local level. So there'll be a whole variety of areas that maybe Peter will touch on in terms from an operational side. We engage with SEPA, but on the strategic side, we've been heavily engaged with them around a sustainable growth agreement for the whole water sector. So everything that we look at in terms of planning from a water resource angle, from improving the urban water environment, is done in conjunction with SEPA. So, for example, about a year ago, we published our urban water route map, looking at how were we going to make yet further improvements to the urban water environment. And that was very much developed in conjunction with SEPA to support them with their river basin management planning objectives. And I think it's tribute to how well we've worked together over the past 20 years that the quality of Scotland's water environment is now so much better than it was many years ago and is by far the best water environment across the UK.
Yeah, just building on what Douglas has said there. So working very closely with SEPA over the years, we've been able to invest significant amounts of money to target that at the areas of the water environment that needs it the most. And we've had significant impacts from that. As Douglas said, the quality of the receiving waters in Scotland is significantly higher than in Europe and the rest of the UK.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Mark Ruskell, I think yours are the next questions.
Yeah, thanks. Morning to you all. I wanted to raise the issue of sewage discharge, which has obviously been very high in the public minds this year. It doesn't appear clear what that picture is in Scotland around sewage discharge, and I think that was a point that was raised by Environmental Standards Scotland when they recently did a sector review, a baseline review. So I wanted just to ask you a number of questions around what that picture actually is in Scotland, and maybe we could start with monitoring. So at the moment, only I think 3% of your combined sewage overflows are actually monitored. Is that really enough to get a clear picture?
Would you allow me just give a little bit of context and I'll come on to the specific of the question. So by way of background, almost linking back to the last question, we've worked really constructively with SEPA ahead of any regulatory period to identify what are the priorities for improvement. And if I go back about 20 years, the big priority area was what are known as point sources of discharge, the continuous outflows from sewage treatment works, and we did a lot of work to improve those. About 15 years ago, SEPA then said, okay, the next big area to start improving are the points of intermittent discharge in the sewer system, which is where we have these emergency release valves that will go off at times of very heavy rainwater. And one of the discussions that we had back then with SEPA and indeed with the Scottish Government was, clearly we've got a finite amount of money. How should we spend that money between putting monitors on our discharge points, on the intermittent discharge points, or putting the money into actually making improvements? And there was universal agreement across SEPA and government, we need to deploy our money to making the physical improvements that have now delivered the improvement in the water environment we've seen over the past 15 years. So it's been a very conscious and collectively agreed decision to prioritise improvements over prioritising monitoring. And that is the reason why today we have relatively low levels of monitors on the discharges in Scotland. However, given now all the progress that we've made, what we all absolutely recognise is part of the next stage of improvement is really having a much finer understanding of precisely what is going on with these discharges. But what we've agreed here, again, it's not to take a blanket approach of putting monitors on all our discharge points. It's actually to target those release valves that may be having the highest risk of an adverse impact on the water environment. And those are the overflows in which we are going to be installing significantly more monitors over the coming years.
OK, so to come back to the question then, that's useful context, but I asked you specifically about the 3%. Is that enough? And do you have a figure for how many CSOs you should be monitoring in order to capture that environmental impact and to understand it?
So hopefully by my earlier answer I've indicated no, it's not enough, and we have now agreed that given where we're at now, we need to be installing more monitors, and we've got an agreed programme with SEPA to install approximately 1,000 monitors on approximately 1,000 of our overflows. And to give you a bit of context, we've got about 3,600 of these emergency overflows across Scotland. And what SEPA said is that there's broadly about a third of them that are the highest priority to get monitors on. And there'll be many benefits from that, not least of which it'll give Peter's team much earlier insight is if an overflow is going off at a time when it shouldn't be. So imagine a day when it's been continuous dry weather. If an overflow is going off in those conditions, it probably indicates that there's a blockage in the system and we need to get out and clear that blockage. So that insight will enable Peter's team to get out there and fix those things much more quickly than we do today, as well as giving information to members of the public
as well. So you've given me a proportion then, a third you'll be moving towards introducing monitoring. What about the two-thirds then that are not monitored? Are you saying that those are not problematic? And how do you know they're not problematic?
So we are primarily relying on SEPA's views as to where are the risks or the threats to the water environment. I think one of the really good things about the approach that SEPA take is they start from an outcome angle. They start from the angle of what is the condition of any water body in Scotland? So what's the condition of the health of any river? And then they work back upstream from that to say, OK, so what needs to happen to either maintain really good status or improve it? And as part of that thinking that they've done, they've said, OK, these third are the priority to get monitors on. Now, once we've got monitors on those, and once we've delivered further improvements to overflows, so we've got also an improvement programme in place, then we'll all determine, is it effective and cost-effective to put further monitors on?
Mm-hmm. Peter, yeah.
Just to build on that, the remaining 2,000-odd monitors, SEPA have indicated that they do not believe that these areas are having any impact on the receiving water. And as Douglas said, the most important thing here is targeting the investment to have the biggest impact. And that's why SEPA start with the river quality, they work back to what investment do you need, and therefore what monitoring should we put in to identify the right investment to deliver the water quality.
So in terms of the discharges that you know that are happening and that you recognise are problematic and that you are monitoring, what proportion of those are deliberate and what proportion of those are accidental discharges? In broad terms.
The way the sewer system operates, they're gravity systems. So any water that comes out of an overflow is really a function of the amount of rainwater that lands on the ground and finds its way into the sewer system, and then at times of really heavy storm. When the total water coming into the sewer system exceeds the downstream hydraulic capacity, that is when the overflows go off. I don't know if that's deliberate or accidental, but that's part of the design system behind the way that these are designed to operate.
So it's totally dependent on rainfall then. There's no control over this. You can't really predict when there is going to be a flow from these CSOs because it's all dependent on the rain.
Rainfall is the primary driver in terms of volume of rainwater. Now, in terms of prediction, we've now got much more sophisticated understanding of what is happening with weather patterns, and then able to correlate that with our understanding of the sewer system. So, for example, if we can see that a big storm is coming in, and through the work of our Intelligent Control Centre, Peter can mobilise his squads to get out and actually make sure that we try and prevent, particularly customers, from suffering problems with flooding. The only other situation where overflows will go off is if there is effectively a material downstream blockage that means that the full flow of rainwater can't get downstream in a sewer and will divert out through an overflow.
Yeah. Okay. It might be useful for the committee to get evidence of, that work programme on the third of CSOs and the investment for that and how that's going to be scheduled. If I could just move briefly on to another related issue, and that's about water quality. I think, Douglas, you said earlier that, Scotland's water quality is excellent. Despite that, again, Environmental Standards Scotland, as part of their sector review, did highlight the fact that a number of the River Basin Management Plan targets have been missed, and that we still have an issue with barriers to fish migration, lamprey migration, and a number of other issues that are related to the operation of Scottish water assets. Can I ask you about how you prioritise environmental compliance? And I'll give you an example. With Loch Venica, I'm aware that SEPA wrote you a letter, I think, last month, confirming that four of your fish passes on the main channel, not on the side channel, but the main channel, are not compliant with your permit. So effectively, you are acting out with your permit conditions, which is, you're operating illegally, in other words. Can I ask how serious you take environmental compliance?
So I'll do the general one, and Peter can probably talk to Loch Venica. We take compliance with all our legal obligations very, very seriously indeed. It's probably one of the top ongoing topics around our boardroom, is to make sure that we are able to discharge the full suite of legal obligations that we have. Part of the reality, however, is we've got a huge infrastructure. We've got about 100,000 kilometres of pipeline. We've got thousands of above-ground assets. And with the best will in the world, things will happen, that things will go awry, which Peter's team are just superb at getting on top of and dealing with, but things will happen that might cause us to breach compliance with one aspect of our regulatory obligations. But the mindset of the organisation, the orientation, the planning, the investment planning is all geared to ensure that we comply with the suite of obligations that we face.
Peter? Okay, yeah, if I can just pick up on Loch Venica. Loch Venica is an interesting structure. It was built in the 1850s. It's unusual in that we've got many, many reservoirs, but in this particular one, it has a dual channel, which is fed from the reservoir into the river. One of the channels is fed through the sluice gates from the reservoir, which we operate. And we do that in line with compensation flows that are set out in legislation by SEPA. And the other channel is fed from the spillway channel, which is effectively the overflow from the reservoir when the reservoir is up at top level.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. I'm aware of
yep.
the geography locally and everything else. I think the issues are with the main flow. So the general point here is around compliance. If SEPA write you a letter like that, What do you then do? Do you then say, well, actually, there's still a problem here, but we have to put it into the investment programme over time? Or do you jump and actually then take action on the
Mark, can we just hear from Peter in answer to your question? And then I'm sort of giving him pre-warning. I'd really like to hear from Alan if he's got anything that he'd like to add to that, because he may have a role.
Yep, so yes, absolutely, we jump when our regulator tells us. I can assure you we do jump. And what we're doing in this, we've worked with SEPA on this to find the right solution. And at the moment, SEPA have requested that we carry out a longer study to try and come to a joint solution on this. So absolutely, we've got actions in place to deal with this.
Okay, and then...
So in terms of investment, what we... have changed, as Douglas mentioned earlier, is we've moved away from a very heavily defined ex-ante list of projects and made broad allowances for Scottish Water to spend on priorities as and when they develop and as and when they're needed. So Scottish Water now has much more flexibility as to how it can respond to a situation. So had investment for the fish pass you mentioned being required in the past, What would have had to happen would have had to mean a change in what we called the technical expression, the long list of projects. And once that change was made, then that investment could go ahead. Now, that wouldn't have to happen. So now Scottish Water can reprioritise money based on appraisal of the situation that it faces.
Thanks.
That's it. OK. Sorry. Thanks very much, Mark. Monica, I think you've got some questions you'd like to ask.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. We heard in the opening statement that inflation and the cost crisis are showing little signs of slowing down. So it's in that context that I'll ask my questions. So first of all, to Douglas Milliken, is it fair to hike household bills by 4.2% during a cost of living crisis?
We've got, clearly, nearly everybody in Scotland is one of our customers. I think about 97% of the Scottish population are customers of Scottish Water. And we do a huge amount to engage with our customers to try and understand what is it that's really important to them about the services that Scottish Water provides and the way we do that. And what comes through absolutely loud and clear is that people have an incredibly high expectation of the service that we will provide for them. They just expect that every day they can turn on the tap and they will get good, clear, high-quality drinking water at the taps, or that they can flush their toilets or the industrial equivalent, and we will take care of that to a really high standard. And then on the very occasional time when something goes a bit awry, that we'll get on top and deal with it. And that is undoubtedly is the overwhelming priority of our customers across Scotland. And that is the thing that we have got to have the greatest attention to. Would be my first point. My second point is, we were discussing in answer to some earlier questions, we have got a whole range of legal obligations that we need to meet. A lot of those are to do with protecting water quality or protecting environmental performance. But then crucially, we then need to think about how do we do all of that in a way that is always sensitive to the position that our customers are in. And there is no doubt that customers are in a really challenging position at the moment, as they have been for many months now. But equally, as we look into the future, unfortunately, it doesn't look as though there's a better day coming in the immediate future. So when we were looking at what did we need to do for charge setting for this current year that we are in, it was very much with a view to, well, what do we need to do for not just for this year, but this year in the context of future years? And that is exactly the same approach that we will take towards charge setting for next year, trying to ensure that we are firstly fulfilling the expectations on us around the level of service that our customers expect, and secondly, making sure that we are being really sensitive to the pressures on customers today, but recognising too there'll be pressures on customers the following year and the years thereafter. And those mix of factors will all go into how we think about charging decisions.
Okay, a lot in that answer, Mr. Milliken. My question was, is it fair to put up prices by 4.2%? So you didn't answer that, but you did say something about not a better day coming in the immediate future. So that sounds quite gloomy. Does that mean that households should brace themselves for further increases? Because the 4.2% increase is pegged to CPI. But we know that inflation is now around 11%. I think it's possibly higher than that. So what should future years look like then? What increases? You talked about high expectations of customers, but are we going to see higher prices?
So my comment about that things look quite challenging, I'm just looking at the general economic forecasts that seem to be all around us at the moment are just predicting that across the economy and for people and for society, that there are some really tough periods ahead over the next 2 or 3 years. So that was a context not to do with water, but to do with the pressures that undoubtedly are on households and on businesses across the country.
Okay. Do you have a view on the fairness of the charging scheme?
So the way the charging scheme is set up is fundamentally is a, a matter for Scottish ministers. They set the principles that apply to water charging in Scotland. What I can say is that there is we have a far more significant differentiation of charge levels between those who are in the most vulnerable position in society and those who perhaps have a greater ability to pay. We've got a much greater differentiation in Scotland than there is elsewhere in the UK. And coming into this price review, ministers took further steps to strengthen the protection for those who find it most difficult to pay by increasing the discount that is available under the water charges reduction scheme. So to give you a sense, there's effectively more than half of Scottish households receive some form of discount or reduction on their water charges. So I'm sure this is a matter that the Scottish Government will keep under review as we go forward, but there have been huge strides taken to try and think very carefully about how do we ensure that water charges can be as affordable as possible for people.
Okay, you mentioned Scottish ministers. I was looking back at what the Cabinet Secretary said about the price increase, and he said that every pound raised is reinvested in our water industry. That was back in February of this year. You know, many customers will be wondering why your cash reserves are £500 million. I know you'll be able to give some explanation for that, but have you looked to see what more can be done to support customers? You clearly understand that many people in Scotland are struggling with affordability of household bills, regardless of their expectations around the quality of service. I wonder if you can just talk to us a little bit more about the reserves. My understanding, reading some of these papers, is that it's sitting at, I think, around double what you would normally have in reserve. Is that something we can expect in coming years, or are you going to be using these reserves in any way to help customers with their bills?
Okay, so probably a number of different elements there. One of the things that we do, is, as Peter was answering earlier, is we have a continual drive for efficiency. So how do we spend the least that we need on delivering whatever it is, whether it's a new investment project or whether it's day-to-day service? So continual drive for efficiency. And that's part of the motivation behind the transformation programme that Peter referred to earlier. But in terms of, if you think about the financing of Scottish Water, ultimately everything that we do is paid for by customers. Now, we might borrow money to fund some of the investment programme, but there's interest in that. Ultimately, it's all paid for by customers. And the easiest way to think about our cash balances, which can vary a bit from year to year, is that's primarily a function of when we borrow from the government relative to when we invest. So there's probably, there is a level of cash balance that we always need to have just to manage the kind of the bumps in the road that come in running a large organisation. And our current view of that is we should probably always have a minimum of about £200 million just so we can deal with whatever pressures come along. But if you like, all the cash that we have at the moment in excess of £200 million, that will all be invested over the coming years as we exit this regulatory period. Those cash balances will come down. So to give you a sense, we're ramping up our investment very significantly. So in this regulatory period, in agreement with the Water Industry Commission, we've been financed for a 30% increase in investment, and we are getting on delivering that. So if I look at our planned investment, last year we delivered a little over £620 million. This year we'll be at least 10% higher than that. So as our investment programme ramps up, those cash balances will, over time, get drawn down.
I'm keen to come to Alan Sutherland in a moment, but just to ask Joanna Dow, in terms of non-domestic customers, what increase will they see in their bills?
For the new year, I can't honestly say yet, because it's dependent on the wholesale cost of water being agreed first. So what I would say, though, is back to my earlier point, we know that we're facing into a really challenging time. So about 70 to 80% of our customers are SMEs, so really small businesses, and they are akin to domestic users of water. So they might have a tap and a toilet in their operation. So from our perspective, it's trying to keep prices as low as we can. But the other big factor there is, how do we encourage the customer to use less water? Because if you're a metered customer, which the majority of ours are, if they use less water, they pay less. And obviously, it's better for the environment as well. So I think we're trying to tackle it on a number of different fronts. But there's no denying it is going to be a really challenging few months for small businesses.
Okay, thank you. Alan, in terms of the view of the Water Industry Commission for Scotland, I was asking Douglas Milliken about the fairness of these charges. What is your view?
I'm not allowed to actually have a view on that, really.
I can have a
personal view, but I can't have a corporate view, because the situation essentially is that my job is to take the objectives of the Scottish ministers and the principles of charging of the Scottish ministers and tease out how much that needs to cost. And I have to do that in a way that has regard to the interests of future customers. So what in the settlement for 21-27 we did was start a journey towards what the levels of investment that we think we can see being required in the future. The price caps that we set are there. Now, Scottish Water has to operate within those price caps. And Scottish Water has to deliver the objectives that the Scottish ministers have set out. And that's what we will then monitor their performance on.
Are these price caps fit for purpose? Is it appropriate? So if the maximum charge is consumer price index plus 2%, and we're looking at inflation of around 11%, and it may increase, is that still going to be the best way to do this?
The question is, how do you want to understand what the future obligations that we will all have to meet are? So if you want to have a water industry that is sustainable and able to replace its assets when the time comes, if you want it to meet net zero challenges, if you want it to be able to adapt to climate change, it's going to have to make the investment. And we collectively as a society are going to have to pay for that in some way. That is a journey that is not a quick journey, because as has been said frequently, we're dealing with some very long life assets here. So we have to get ourselves into a situation where we're operating in a fit for purpose way. Now, what the price caps are doing essentially is giving you an indication of what the what a reasonable path between now and the middle of the century would be, 2040 plus. The variations in charging can be significant within those caps, but the caps are broadly what is going to be required over time.
And just finally, and I know it's never polite to talk about people's salaries and remuneration, but I'm going to put this to Dame Susan Rice, because it's not fair to put this to the officers, but just to get it on the public record, there's obviously been a lot of interest in the bonus structure for senior officials. So when we're talking about the time when members of the public are really struggling to afford the absolute basics in life, including water charges, it was mentioned about looking at efficiencies. Is there any reflection or review ongoing into the bonus structure for Scottish Water officials?
So I would say that the bonus structure is one that was agreed some years ago and with government, so that's been in place for a while. I would point out that the bonus structure for the executives in the organisation is based on what we call outperformance, and outperformance is measured at a very fine level. So there are expectations and goals and targets, as all businesses have. This is a business that strives, for lots of reasons, to outperform those. And if they work hard at that and achieve the outperformance, they will have, there's a computation that will give some bonus. It's not paid every year. It's varied. It's not just an assumption that people will get that. I'd also point out that all people who work and are performing at an appropriate level in the organization right throughout are eligible to receive something as well. So it's a pretty if one compared commercially, it's a very modest, forgive me for saying that to my colleagues, but it's a very modest bonus program. But it is something that incentivizes, which is what that kind of program should do, the very hard work, the creative work, to go beyond is considered sort of acceptable levels of performance and move this business further and faster. Douglas spoke at the beginning about being high cost and low quality 20 years ago, if you will, 15, 20 years ago, and now complete reverse, where we're one of the lowest cost providers in the UK. And the service, the quality of what is done is just right at the top of the charts. And that comes from the outperformance that we're rewarding. So I think the judgment of the board is this is something that works. We discuss it. We have a remuneration committee, and these matters are discussed at the full board as well. And the feeling would be that this is actually effective and working.
Thank you. I'll conclude, I think, because my initial questions were about fairness and the assessment of fairness. I think it was important just to take the temperature on that. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Monica. I've got some questions on the accounts, which form a huge part of your report. And caused me a certain amount of heartache to understand last night, but you're going to shed some light on it. Page 153, administrative expenses for the latest year were reduced by 60 million. That's an 8%. How did you manage that, very briefly?
I have 20 seconds to refer to the underlying element. The reason I'm just going to pause for a minute, because that will be... That is a consolidated number across Scottish Water and Business Stream, and a lot can come down to the way that costs are classified.
Douglas, so, rather than put you on the spot flicking through that, I'm very happy to take a written answer on that if you don't have it to hand.
I think I would prefer that, because what we do within the financial commentary is effectively break it down into a little bit more detail across Scottish Water and across Business Stream in terms of the key cost elements. So, as I say, 30 seconds and I could find the precise...
Douglas, I'm happy if you're going to answer these that you can refer them all back to me in written answers to give you a chance. But I'm also concerned about the taxation went from 7.9 million to 158 million. Now, I understand there was some differentiation in tax due to corporation tax, but that is massive difference. Again, you can write to the committee with an answer if you like.
No, I think that one is easier to answer, because there's a particular note on page 168 to the accounts. The key thing to highlight is that we at the moment pay relatively little in corporation tax. Most of the tax charge relates to a deferred tax liability on taxation that may be payable in the future, and it's all to do with the timing of when taxable profits are earned relative to the unwinding of capital allowances. And the primary reason for the change there was effectively to do with the anticipated change in the corporation tax rate of increasing it to 25%
from 19%.
That was the primary reason.
It seems a huge jump. It's all down to that, is it?
And that's affected our decisions of the UK government in terms of where they set corporation tax rates. So if you were to track back this over many years, we'd have had a favourable credit to our accounts, when the UK government were reducing the rate of corporation tax. When they then signalled the increase, those favourable credits were then reversed.
OK, but it went from 1 year from 19% to 25%, increase was from 7 million to 158 million. That seems to be quite large.
But it's simply because we've got a very significant deferred tax liability. Mm-hmm. The good thing about that's tax that may be payable, not yet paid. And it's purely about how that is revalued from 19% mm-hmm. to 25%.
Then on page 164, the operating surplus for Scottish Water has gone from basically up 20 million and business stream has gone from a loss to a credit. It's quite substantial figures there, changes. Again, I'm happy to take a written answer, or Joanna, if you want to answer, I'm happy to take it.
Yeah, no, I think I can comment on the business stream aspect of it. So a couple of different drivers there, but the key one was the recovery in consumption levels that we talked about earlier as a result of COVID unwinding. The second one is that we'd carried fairly extensive provisions for bad debt on the back of COVID in anticipation that a number of customers would really find it difficult to pay their bills. So within our reported results for 21-22, it includes a release from the COVID bad debt provision of almost £29 million. So that's obviously a significant driver in that swing from a loss the previous year to a profit this year. And then from our perspective as well, there were additional efficiency savings that were generated as a result of synergies from the acquisitions that we've done in recent years too.
Douglas, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I think probably the best way to answer it is to provide something in writing by a slightly more granular answer. But there can be a number of factors that play. I think the key thing when you're looking at the finances of a water company is actually the cash flow statement, because there can be some... And I do say this as a chartered accountant myself, but accounting standards can have some strange impacts on the way that accounts of a utility are presented, particularly the way that issues around the costs associated with long life assets can be reflected from year to year in the income statement. So I always find that the cash flow statement is a key thing probably to look at. But the factors that will be at play was that there was a 2.5% increase in our charge income coming into that particular year. We're typically seeing, in terms of our customer base, it growing by nearly 1% a year, really as a function of the new house building and house connections across Scotland. On the cost side, there's a continuing drive for efficiency. But there will be some of these one-off or these adjustments to do with the application of accounting standards that probably we should give you just a written answer to your question.
Okay, thank you. I'll take that. And then the final question is, under staff costs, wages and salaries increase from 168.7 million to 173.4 million, which I understand is roughly a 3% increase. I understand that. Where are we predicting we're going to be after addressing the cost of living crisis? Is that going to be considerably more? When do you negotiate your wages and staff costs?
So our pay deal for this financial year was agreed with our employees through our three trade unions back in, I think, May time. And the pay uplift for all our people has been paid. So that is all agreed for this year. In terms of next year, clearly that is something that we will need to address with our three trade unions in the context of the relevant public sector pay policy for next financial year.
I missed the answer. What was the increase that was agreed in May?
The average increase was 4.9%.
Okay, but it's likely to increase on that. It was a one-off, a one-year agreement.
That was the pay deal for last year. It was an average of 4.9%, but some differentiation across that. So typically people who are lower in their pay bands would get a higher level of increase. But it's too early to say yet what the parameters will be for next year's pay settlement.
Okay. There are some supplementary questions. I'm going to come back to the Deputy Convener, Fiona, and then to Liam.
So I'd like to address the Water Industries Commission and ask you, Alan, is do you think that the statutory responsibilities that you have provide sufficient scope to help you challenge Scottish Water on delivering its net zero commitments?
I think the statute is fine. We have the ability to ask whatever questions we think we need to ask. We're currently engaged in an iteration of questions and answers. We haven't yet finished that process for this year that ended in March. There's a ways to go. We're hoping to have it finished before the end of the year. I'm not necessarily entirely holding my breath that we'll be finished by then, because we had rather a lot of queries this year. The powers are there. I think we are of a view that the triple challenge that I referred to earlier of the investment to adapt to climate change, to mitigate climate change, and to replace assets in an optimised way. So the question of meters, for example, replacing meters, you'd replace it with the modern variant, not just with what you had before. We'd regard that as a really, really significant challenge. We went on record with the last price review of saying that we thought the challenges that face Scottish Water going forward are at least as significant as the ones that they incredibly successfully addressed when the three authorities were brought together to create Scottish Water back in 2002. So there are real challenges there. The monitoring will continue to be robust and evidence-based, and we'll report on that.
Why did you have so many queries this year?
That's a good question. I would like to know the answer of that myself, but there's just been a lot. The last 2 or 3 years, it's been more queries.
Queries from you or from elsewhere?
What happens is that we have what we call an annual return. Mm-hmm. It's a very detailed document, originally developed in its baby form by the Treasury back in the 1980s. And it was sort of taken forward by Ofwat in the 1990s, and we adopted it here back in 1999-2000. It basically looks at all aspects of performance, assets, levels of service, climate, and that gets completed every year. It's very extensive, it requires commentaries, and what we go through is pretty forensically going through that document and asking and checking the consistency of the report, making sure that we're happy with it.
So can I also ask about your relationship with SEPA? Clearly, it's not just a net zero climate change emergency. We've got a biodiversity crisis to deal with as well. So we've heard a lot, Peter particularly referring to SEPA, and clearly there's different regulators. Do you think that kind of regulatory setup facing those two twin crises works, and how do you work with SEPA in their regulatory role?
We sit down with SEPA regularly, both as part of the wider stakeholder meetings that happen probably a couple of times a month roughly on average, and have separate conversations with SEPA on a bilateral basis as well, to make sure that we understand what is important to them, and we share what our views of progress on investment and the like are with them.
And just finally to ask Susan Rice if you can maybe talk about what is the priority for the board going forward in terms of that strategic challenge, and to what extent does biodiversity sit in with that, as well as obviously the climate change and these things that the board are addressing, and are there any issues in that terms of that SEPA versus also Water Commissioner regulatory constraint?
You've raised a really important point, which is around biodiversity, and implied in that is relationship to net zero and targets. So Scottish Water has its own net zero target, which it has undertaken to achieve 5 years sooner than the Scottish Government's target. And actually, we're working to try to get there even faster. Biodiversity... And if you talk to pundits around this space externally, no one will really achieve the net zero targets without dealing with biodiversity. That is fundamental to making all of this work. So Scottish Water, and this is, just have to say, this is a real personal interest of mine, and I do a lot of things related to this outside of Scottish Water, but Scottish Water for years, not just since the climate emergency was declared here in Scotland some years ago, but well before that, has focused on biodiversity. It has, for instance, right now, and this doesn't solve all problems, but it's important, a massive tree planting operation. But it's very interested in peatlands, because if peatlands are healthy and restored, that helps the quality of water. If we get better quality water, then we have to expend less by way of both money, chemicals, mm-hmm. carbon, and so forth in treating the water. So these matters are just absolutely tied together. And for the board, these are very important. I've mentioned my own personal interest, but the whole board has an interest, and several of our non-execs specifically have a background and experience in that area, biodiversity and climate change and emissions.
Thank you.
Mark, if you're very quick, I'll bring you in, or has your question been answered?
It was a slightly different question. I'll be very quick, convener. I just wanted to ask Joanna Dow about the privatised market of the billing and sale of water to business customers. Do you feel that is actually working? Have there been efficiencies, or could you operate just as effectively as a state monopoly?
Maybe I can answer the first part of that question, not necessarily the second part. So what I would say is we've operated now with a commercial competitive environment in Scotland for 15 years and in England for 5 years. And I can definitely attest to the fact that there's been significant benefits delivered for customers, both in terms of reduced charges, but also innovation, better quality service experience as well. So I'm a big advocate of a competitive market. I think we can demonstrate quite clearly that it has delivered benefits for customers and will continue to do so.
Okay. Liam, you wanted to come in.
Thank you, Kavina. Very briefly, Douglas Milliken, you talked earlier about 97% of Scotland getting high quality water, but we've also heard about the cost of delivering that. The cost is very challenging. Now, it's been argued that as domestic water is not metered, perhaps the true cost and value to the end user of the product is not sufficiently appreciated. And also, we've heard about the importance of encouraging people to use less. So perhaps if it's not metered, the argument would go, people won't do so. The flip side, as I think we heard from Joanna Dow earlier, is that metering costs, you've got installation, you've got maintenance, you've got the actual reading of it. What is Scottish Water's current view on meters for domestic customers?
So the current view is that any domestic customer can ask for a meter and we will supply it, but in accordance with the effective principles of charges that apply for this period, is if you want a meter as a customer, then you need to pay for the installation of that. And I think the reality is there's quite a significant cost about installing, reading, maintaining meters, and then issuing the bills on it. So I think the setup that we have in Scotland, by having unmeasured customers, apart from addressing issues around affordability, allowing some of the differentiation that applies, it also helps to keep the cost of the whole system down. But if I then get to the whole issue around, so how do you incentivise water efficiency? And I think I'm not wholly convinced that a meter per se does that. I mean, clearly, if you are somebody who is absolutely struggling and every penny counts, then you're watching your water meter, maybe it does have some bearing. But for many customers, they're not watching their water meter. So the approach we're taking is to try and inform and make people aware of the scope for them to save money by saving water, and largely through their energy bills. So we've done some work over a number of years with the Energy Saving Trust, identifying the percentage of somebody's energy bill that is associated with heating water. And we've been to various events over time and trying to engage customers in and around that. But we've currently got a campaign running at the moment on mainstream media and social media under the title of Water's Always Worth Saving. So Peter referenced earlier that, for example, in times of drought, we might go out to customers with messages encouraging them to save water. But actually the key message, and we intentionally launched this even in a wet Scottish autumn, was to actually convey to people across Scotland that actually all year round, water is always worth saving, and particularly we've tapped at the moment to the saving they can make on their energy bills by reducing the amount of water that they consume and heat.
It's fascinating. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks very much, Liam. And Jackie's been sitting very quietly in the corner. I'm sure you've got some questions you want to put forward now.
Thank you very much to the convener and the committee for allowing me to pose some questions. I have indeed seen those adverts and they work very effectively. But my questions are in the context of the cost of living crisis, which I think is probably the worst in more than a generation. Can I turn first to the Water Industry Commissioner? Your website reveals that you wrote to Scottish Water on the 3rd of February 2022 after they set a charge level which was 2% below that which you determined would be required. Your 3rd of February letter makes clear, and I quote, "Our final determination set out a 2% average annual real increase in charges from 21-22 to 26-27, so that's CPI plus 2%. The letter goes on to demand an explanation of Scottish Water as to how it will deliver the required investment in a manner consistent with our final determination of charges. The letter also makes clear that charges would now need to increase by more than CPI plus 2%. Further correspondence to Scottish Water on 10th of March, 25th of April and 1st of July demands information to demonstrate Scottish Water is doing what you want. With inflation at 11.1%, that would imply, would it not, Scottish Water having to raise its charges by at least 14% next year if they were to follow your approach. However, a recent answer to a parliamentary question I tabled makes clear, and I quote, "No powers to require a particular outcome in the charge setting process beyond setting the charge caps." So it doesn't appear that you have the powers to demand what you're actually demanding of Scottish Water. So can I ask, will you now withdraw the letter of the 3rd of February and take the pressure off Scottish Water to have inflation-busting rises forced on customers during a cost-of-living crisis?
Well, I think, Ms Bailey, as you've said, we have no power to compel Scottish Water to do anything. What we set is a charge cap. Now, what we have set is a charge cap, which we believe is the lowest reasonable overall cost, which is the statutory test, for Scottish Water to deliver all of the objectives of the Scottish ministers consistent with the Scottish ministers' principles of charging. Right? So if there is less revenue coming into the system, unless there is offsetting efficiency, and that's what we would want to understand. Unless there's offsetting efficiency, there will be less investment. And if there is less investment, we are simply wanting to understand how it is Scottish Water is going to meet the full objectives set out by the Scottish Minister. And if there's going to be a shortfall, then there needs to be a process to discuss that. So, quite simply, the question is, the objectives are there, there's an amount of money that's required, in our view, the lowest reasonable overall cost, right? What's giving in the system? If you're taking less money, that's fine, right? It's under the charge cap, right? But how are you then delivering the objectives and how are you delivering the promises that have been made to the people of Scotland?
Given that I think you acknowledge you have no power to demand what you were demanding in your letter of 3rd of February. Will you withdraw that letter? And if ministers, because they ignored what you said last year, ignore you again and come down on the side of householders, isn't it the case that it really is up to ministers to act and not you?
It's up for ministers ultimately through the Parliament own Scottish Water, right? They get to work with Scottish Water and to decide whatever they want. The question that is, if you've set out a set of objectives, we have in good faith costed that set of objectives, and we've come to a conclusion as to how much money is required to do that, having included a fairly substantial efficiency challenge, 1% compounded, in both operating costs and capital costs, right? So if you are going to have less revenue in the system, right, you are going to have less investment, right? Unless you're going to have efficiencies over and above the efficiencies, which are very challenging, right, ahead of anything that's been set south of the border, right? What's giving in the system? Quite simple, right? So, you know, yes, we cannot pay now, but we'll then pay later, or we won't get what we were told we were going to get.
I think you'll acknowledge that circumstances can change, though. We are now in a cost of living crisis that I don't think you anticipated when you put your determination of charges forward. Given that the Minister has effectively overruled that for last year, and one hopes would give this consideration this year, when circumstances change, should you not change, or have you had a discussion with ministers about revising their objectives?
I'm finding this very interesting, but the situation that, as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, I'm just looking for clarity, is that what you're trying to point out is that Scottish Water won't be able to meet their objectives unless they put the prices up to the level that you've suggested. So it's a balance between investment or non-investment. So surely it would be for Scottish Water then to explain what projects they are unable to achieve if the price doesn't go up. Have I got this completely wrong?
You're absolutely correct. And that's what we were seeking to ascertain in issuing an information request in March to Scottish Water, which is something that we are still working on. So we are trying to understand exactly what is going to give in the system. Because there is less money in the system as of today. The charge caps are there. The facility is there to take the money. It may be that the decision is that that can't be afforded, but then there will be less investment in the system less quickly. And maybe that happens later. Maybe it has to wait for a new regulatory period. Maybe ministers accept a shortfall in their objectives. That's for ministers to decide. What we're doing is simply saying what's happening and how much does it cost, right? We're just holding a mirror up to all of us in society.
Okay, sorry, Jackie. Thank you for clarifying that. I thought I was off track, sorry.
It might be helpful if I share with the committee a copy of the letter of the 3rd of February, which is quite specific and says, as a result, charges would now need to increase by more than CPI plus 2% in each of the next 4 years. There is very little mention of the narrative we've just heard about, you know, what projects would require to be cut. So I have made the point, I think. I wonder whether actually there has been a discussion with ministers about revisiting objectives before I turn to Scottish Water.
I've had a conversation with ministers about revising objectives.
You've not sought a conversation?
I've not sought a conversation. It's for ministers to say to me
indeed
what objectives they have, and it's for ministers to say to me what period they want advice for.
And sorry, presumably Scottish Water have explained to you what projects they will be unable to deliver without those things. That's part of the discussion, is it?
It's part of the discussion. It's a process that is ongoing.
So, and the flip side to that is it could be that they ask the Scottish Government for more money to fund the fact that they're not getting this investment from revenue to allow them to carry out those projects if the Scottish Government had the money.
Well, Scottish Water is going to have to answer for itself, but the circle needs squaring.
Susan or Douglas, do you want to answer on that?
Thank you. So, this is This is probably the dominant topic on our board agenda and has been for months. And actually, the references earlier to our annual report. So let me just anchor it back in our annual report, where in my chief executive section on page 19, I did talk about what we did, the charging decision that we took last year, and then recognise that this is really difficult territory, because there is no doubt that the households and businesses are under immense pressure. As answered in response to an earlier question, will I think continue to be under pressure, not just for next year but beyond? And yet customers expect the services, and because those services are delivered through infrastructure, the investment is required. And on top of that, we've got a whole raft of legal obligations on us in primary legislation and the minister's objectives. And therefore, we cannot resolve this on our own. We are accountable, obviously, to Youth Parliament, but through the Scottish ministers. So there is an active dialogue between our board and our cabinet secretary at the moment on how we move through here. And effectively, there are only so many different moving parts here. There is, to what extent can we reduce the financing burden in this period because of the success of our transformation programme and efficiency? And we hope there will be something in there, but it's already, as Alan said, on top of the pre-stretching efficiency targets they put in. So we are looking, how can we contribute to lessening the demand? There may, and I do stress may, at the margins, be scope for moving some investment from this period into the next period, but it'll be the margins, and it would have to be if it was agreed with the quality regulators. And all that, if even that is agreed, all that is doing is shoving burden from the group of customers in this six-year period to the group of customers in the next six-year period. So big picture is most of the money that is set out in the determination will be required across these 6 years. And arguably, through the limiting of price increase for this year, we've already foregone £140 million of the financing that we were eligible for. So we've already effectively committed to £140 million of peddling harder. So when it then comes to how do we fill the financing gap over the rest of the period, there are only three things that can move. What happens to charges next year? What happens on average with charges in the following 3 years, so years 4 to 6 of the regular period, and question whether the government would want to and have the ability to or choose to put any additional borrowing into the system. Those are the only variabilities. The one thing I would be, just to be very clear about, is the charges cap that the Commission set is an average of CPI plus 2 across the period. That does not follow that every year is CPI plus 2. So, for example, one of the other principles of charging is around the importance of stability in charging for customers. So, whatever we end up in this year, we'll be cognizant of where might inflation go over the balance of period and make sure that we're not doing anything undue in this year, just in a year of potentially peak inflation. But absolutely, we've got to balance this. And balance the different sensitivities and pressures. And that's why there is an ongoing dialogue with government on this. We've got a bit of time because charges ultimately, they need to go through a regulatory process, but they don't need to be published until probably late January, February.
OK, and I think that actually, well, Jackie, if you're very quick.
I will certainly try, Convener. It is to Scottish Water, because last year you did listen to the Minister. You reduced the charge from 6.2 to 4.2%. The Water Industry Commissioner, as I've explained, wrote to you on the 3rd of February, basically trying to unpick that. And the consequence of that would be that you could be in a position to place eye-watering rises on households and businesses that are all peddling harder of something like 14%. So I would like a commitment from you today that an above-inflation price rise is off the table and that a price freeze remains open for consideration.
No decision has been made by the board yet, but in terms of the factors that are under consideration are absolutely looking at what is it that we need to do to be sensitive to customers this year and to be sensitive to customers' economic predicament in the following years of the price review, and also to ensure that we meet the expectation of customers and the obligations that are on us. So it is all those factors will go into the mix that ultimately will determine what percentage we land on for next year.
So I suppose it depends whose side you're on, whether it's the regulator or householders.
I think that's quite hard, Jackie, and in fairness, I think you should actually, I've given you a fair crack of the whip on it. It's a balance that they've got to achieve, and I don't need to stick up for Scottish Water, and I know the regulator will do it, and I know the minister will also take an interest in it. I think you've made your point about the difficulties of price rises, and we all understand them. And I think you've heard from Scottish Water that they're trying to grapple with how to resolve what they need to raise to invest, run their business, and take into account the customers. You've had a fair crack at it, if I may be so bold as to say. And to say that, thank you very much, everyone. Susan, I apologise profusely for not giving you your opening statement. I am in your debt for forgiving me on that, but I'd like to thank you all for the effort and the contributions you've made this morning. So thank you very much indeed. I'm going to suspend the meeting to allow us to set up for the next bit. Thank you. Welcome back. Our next item of consideration is a negative instrument, the Electricity Application for Consent and Variation of Consent, Fees Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. This instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. Now, at this stage, no motions to annul have been laid. Do members wish to make any comments on the instrument? Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, clearly this is about resourcing the system, the application system, in a better way. And, you know, I note the move to full cost recovery. I suppose the question that I would have is, you know, what will this do to performance? Because we have taken evidence in this committee where, you know, we've been told by the industry that it has taken 7 years for an application to be determined. The whole system is very slow, whether that's applications going to local councils or going to DPA and Scottish Government. So I suppose my question here would be around, you know, will this make a significant difference to those determination timescales? We're in a climate emergency, we need business certainty, you know, we need to see applications either being approved or rejected within a reasonable timescale. So I'm interested to know, is this going to properly resource the decision-making structure and process?
Does anyone else have any comments? Fiona.
Yeah, it's a fair point, but clearly the new NPF4 is partly about improving timescales for approvals, and clearly in terms of expenses, I think that's a question we can come back to on the basis that let's see if this helps improve, but it won't be the only factor. But I think in terms of, you know, recovering costs for support for planning applications, we know we have to move there, so it's a sensible thing to do. But in terms of the proof of that, will be after the effect, and we can monitor that together with the NPF4 changes and regulations.
Okay, I mean, there's nothing. I think where we're at is that these are sensible things, regulation to move through. But I think there's nothing to stop us writing to the minister and say that you have raised these concerns, and then see if we get a response, and then monitor it in the future to see, as the deputy convener has suggested, whether that's had the effect. That probably by alerting the minister. And, of course, it's on the official record that those points being raised would be the way forward. Mark, would you be...
Yeah, I mean, I have no concerns about supporting this SI. It's more about what it is trying to achieve, what will be the outcome of this. And I would expect the outcome would be better timescales for determination coming out of it. But, you know, I'd like to know from government whether that will actually happen.
Okay, so if the committee is happy, I will write to, as a result of this meeting, to the minister to allay those points. But my question, therefore, substantially to you is, are you happy that we are not going to make any further recommendations or written recommendations regarding the instruments, and that we're happy to allow them to go through?
Agreed.
Good, we are agreed. That concludes then the public part of the meeting, and we'll now move into private session.